to Math Homework Hotline, where we do the math. I'm Maggie Mixon.
And I'm Grayson Casco, and our fun theme tonight is Winter Wonderland, if you couldn't tell.
You guys, we're so excited and pumped because this is our last show of 2023, our last live show. You can always watch us on the rebroadcast, but right now on the phones, we have teachers waiting to hear from you. Spectrum Channel 635, if you're here local, Frontier Channel 32, and always call us in. Truly, come get your questions answered. Do the math with us. 813-840-7260. We are super excited because tonight is a night that culminates the From August Till Now shows.
So we finally made it. It's been a while. It's been a while to get here, but we finally made it halfway through the year, getting ready for those midterms.
Yay. All right, so what is tonight's math theme?
Let's see that topic. Our topic tonight is the first semester review. So we are culminating everything that we've done the past couple of weeks throughout the entire first semester, and we're gonna review all of it tonight. How fun does that sound?
That sounds super exciting, guys. So we're gonna have questions for sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade. So tonight we're actually gonna have three different challenge questions. Remember that you can take us on the go on the website, mathhomeworkhotline.com. We are live streaming right now as our teachers are answering the phones. Remember that as soon as we start introducing the topics or the challenge questions on the topic of this review, you want to be able to snap those pictures, work out the problem, and be the first caller to be able to call in, get the question right, and explain it to one of our tutors on the phone so you could be our winner, our Jemmy winner. So tonight we'll not have just one, but three Jemmy winners according to your grade level. So one sixth grade question, one seventh grade question, one eighth grade question. And we're definitely gonna be hoping to hear from you. I know we already have on the phone somebody that wants to do math with us. It's gonna take us just a minute though, because we want to be able to show you those challenge questions.
Yeah,
all right?
So get your phones out, get ready to take those pictures. They're about to come up right now. Let's see those challenge questions.
Sixth grade first, sir.
Yes, sixth grade first. All right, our first challenge problem of the night for grade six and grade six only. So sorry, seventh and eighth graders, but you cannot join on this one. If you're in sixth grade, get your phone out, take a picture. Your challenge problem says, in buying ground beef for hamburgers, there are several packages from which to choose as shown in the table below. So there you go, you have a table with pounds of ground beef and the cost for it per pound. Part A. What is the unit cost of the ground beef? And part B, does the unit cost differ depending on the package size? Be ready to explain your reasoning. So go ahead, take that picture right now. And if you're the first one to call in, get the correct answer and explain it, we're gonna put you on air and you will be our Jemmy Award winner for grade six tonight.
Woohoo! I know we have plenty of excited sixth graders out there. The next question is going to be for our seventh graders. And I actually had a seventh grader say today, this is my favorite day of the week. It's Math Homework Hotline Thursday. I'm like, woohoo! True story over at Benito Middle School. All right, let's roll our seventh grade question. For grade seven and grade seven only, are the following expressions equivalent? So in the first parentheses, you see 7x minus 4. And then minus the second parentheses, 2 minus 1 half x. So you could think of as the quantity 7x minus 4 minus the quantity of 2 minus 1 half x. We're not going to give you any hints because this is a review night. Now, is that first expression and the second expression 15 over 2 or 15 halves x minus 6? Are those two expressions equivalent? Be ready to explain how you determine this. All right, for seventh grade and seventh grade only. So if you're a seventh grader and you know that answer, make sure you call in, let them know you're in seventh grade and that you have the answer with an explanation. All right, what's the eighth grade one?
We got one more problem for our eighth graders out there. If you're in eighth grade, get your phone out, get ready to take our picture of this challenge problem for you guys. All right, our challenge problem for eighth graders. It says the following side lengths in meters were given to you to build a front porch with a triangular design. Determine which set of lengths will make a triangle to be able to use it in your design, and be ready to explain your reasoning. So you have three different options here. Option one says that the side lengths 4, 4, and 8 will make a triangle. Option 2 says side lengths 6, 8, and 10. And option 3 has side lengths 6, 6, and 13. So you have to choose which option is the one that's going to make a triangle and explain why. So get your phone out, take a picture of that if you're in grade 8, and make sure you're the first one to call in with the correct answer so you can be our Gemmy Award winner for that grade.
Woohoo! All right, Grayson, so what do they win?
Oh, my favorite part.
When they call in.
So not only will you be a Gemmy Award winner and have a plaque sent straight to your class with your name on it, Math Homework Hotline, but you also get a bunch of other goodies in a tote bag sent right to you. You will have a Math Homework Hotline t-shirt, so you'll be matching with us.
Woohoo!
You'll have a bunch of supplies, pencil cases, pencils, rulers, erasers, sharpeners, and my favorite part, the free food.
Woohoo!
Shout out to Chick-fil-A and McDonald's. You will get free food sent right to you to use on whatever you want to order from there. And that's really the best part of ordering in, because who doesn't love free food?
Exactly. So guys, last week we had a student at Benito Middle School, Preston, who won the challenge. And I got to go visit him. We'll see a picture of him shortly here, where he and his teacher were super excited to see all these prizes, you know, come to life, if you will. They were in the beginning of class and I said, hey, let's take a quick picture and big round of applause for Preston. So Preston at Benito Middle School, who also missed Applegarth's classes, are trying desperately hard tonight to be able to be the next Gemmy teacher in class, because for the last 4 weeks, so three shows prior to this one and this one, we have our culmination of the Teacher Gemmy Award, and that contest is running through just tonight. So whoever has the most phone calls for their class is going to become that Gemmy teacher winner and class winner. So we're super excited about hearing how that's going to turn out as well.
Yes, and remember that once you win, you cannot win it again. But the best part of this is if you're the teacher that wins, then they get to provide an entire class set with free food. And really, that's the best part. If you are in that class and you are calling in the most, you're getting to get everybody in that class free food with you. So that's Woo-hoo! Really the best part of it.
And guys, lots of shout outs tonight. I'm going to tell you, last week we ended up with Farnell getting a quick shout out because they were in the district championship for the volleyball game, for the girls volleyball. They didn't win. They did indeed win. It sounded like I said it, they didn't win, but they did. They got recognized this week as our girls volleyball champions for the district.
Also, congratulations to them.
FSU ACC champions, baby. Oh, so big Florida State fan over here. And of course, the Swifties out there. Taylor Swift with Person of the Year recently. With all that, great lots of shout outs for you. But we have one caller right now on the phone that's ready to do some math with us. Grayson, take it away.
Yes, let's get started right away. Am I speaking with Harshit from Ferguson?
Miss
William from Ferguson's class at Williams?
Yes.
Hi, how you doing tonight? Are you ready to do the math with me?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's just jump right into it. So, if we could go to my board, I already have the problem ready for us. My first question of the night says, Alex asked 32 of his coworkers if they like soccer. 24 of them said yes. What percent do not like soccer? So this is a percentage problem that we're working with here. Do you know anything about percents?
Yes.
Okay, let's get started then. What do you think I should do to start tackling this problem?
So, we need to do
a little louder, I'm sorry.
We need to do 32 minus...
Okay, so I have 24 out of the 32, so I need to make a fraction, right?
Yes.
Okay, and what would go on top if it's 24 out of 32?
So
I'm going to put the 24 on the top because it's out of the 32. So it goes like this, right?
Yeah.
Now there's two different ways that I can solve this. If I have 24 out of 32, I can just do 24 divided by 32, multiply that to 100. Or if you're a person who likes to use the butterfly or the fish method, another way you could solve this is by doing 24 over 32 and equaling that to an X percent out of 100. Which method do you like to use? The one on the left or the one on the right?
On the right.
On the right, I like that one too.
Me too.
So let's do that one on the right. So I have 24 out of 32, and we want to see what the percent out of 100 that is, because we already know the most percent you can have is 100%, mm-hmm. right? So what method do you like to use to solve this type of problem?
Division.
Okay, but there's two steps. Before we divide, we have to do what?
24, 32, and then 5.
So I'm going to multiply.
Yes.
Right? Like a butterfly.
Now you said the fish and the butterfly method.
The fish and the butterfly, same thing.
Lots of
lots of different methods, yeah. So when we multiply these, 24 times 100, what do you get?
2,400.
You got it.
2,400. And we're going to equal that to 32 times x, which would just be?
25%.
You got it.
32x. Okay. Now we can do what you said. We're going to divide here, right? So if we're going to divide this 32 so we can get x by itself, that will get rid of those 32s on this side, leaving us just the x. And all we have to do to figure out what x equals is do 2,400 divided by 32. What do you get as an answer? 2,400 divided by 32.
Yeah.
So the answer would be 25%, right? Is that what you got?
Yes, I got that.
Awesome.
Good job.
Good job.
So that is amazing work to start off and
yes,
kick us off, you guys. We also have a sixth grade challenge winner.
Oh, that was
fast. Very exciting. Is this Shrika? Shrika?
Yes, I'm here.
Hey, Grayson's going to do this question with you. He has it ready on his board.
Yes,
we are
I
so
do.
Excited. You're the first one of the three different grade levels to call in tonight. Congratulations, honey. All right, let's do it.
You ready to start the problem with me?
Yes.
Okay, let's go ahead and jump right into it. So I already have it set up for us. If you remember what the problem says, it's like if buying ground beef for hamburgers, there are several packages from which to choose from. And I already drew them on the table right here. So our first part of this question says, what is the unit cost of the ground beef? So how would I go about solving this?
So you need to do a division.
Perfect. I do need to divide.
Yeah. So I would do the cost divided by the pound. So one of them would be 7.44 divided by 2.
Perfect. So we are going to do the cost divided by, the cost divided by the pounds.
And then I got
3.72. Right. $7.44 divided by 2. And that gives you the total of $3.72. That is correct.
Yes.
Would it matter which of these pairs I divided by, the cost divided by the pounds? Could I have done any of them?
Yes, you could, because whenever you did any of them, you always guess 3.72, so no, it does not matter.
Perfect.
Very
it
nice.
Does not. I can do any of them. 5.58 divided by 1.5, 11.16 divided by 3, and I'll get this same answer every time. So that pretty much answers part B. Does the unit cost differ depending on the package size?
No.
No, it does not.
Congratulations.
They are all $3.72. Thank you so much for helping me with that problem. You
that's
did great.
Per pound, right?
Yes, per pound. Per pound.
Very good, guys. That was our sixth grade Jemmy winner. We already have our seventh grade Jemmy winner on the line. Talia, are you there?
Yep.
And guess what? Right after you, we have the eighth grade one, Grayson.
Oh, that was
all
quick.
All three challenge questions. I don't know if these were such a challenge if we got all three callers so quick. All right, Miss Talia, walk me through this. I have two different expressions, one that's really long and one that's not so long. It only has those two terms. Are these equivalent was the original question?
Yes.
How do you know?
Because when I simplified the answer to the equation, I got 7.5 minus 6.
All right. So can you help me work out this first expression so viewers at home can see how that worked out so that it is equal to the second term or the second expression?
Yes.
Go ahead.
So I first switched both my questions to teach and And then I split 1/2 minus 6 divided by 7.
So it sounded like, though, we needed to distribute this subtraction sign?
Yes.
All right, so we distributed that subtraction sign so we could get rid of those parentheses on that second expression. Now we have those four terms without any of those parentheses. All right, and then you were telling me you were combining like terms?
Yes. And then I deducted the 4 as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I could switch it to 2.
All right, so if I'm looking at this correctly, and you're telling me the ones with the X versus the ones that don't have the X, so 7x plus 1/2 x is 7.5 x's?
Yes, it is.
All right. And then looking at the constants, the ones that don't have any x's, I have a minus 4 and a minus 2. So a negative 4 is being added with a negative 2. What do I get with that?
You got negative
6. You got it.
So you can do it like 7.5 minus 6, or 7.5
next. Exactly. So, and then the 7.5, it just looks like a mixed number here, but an improper fraction there, right? So those are equivalent forms. Very nice. Everything checks out. Congratulations. You are our 7th grade Gemmy winner from Ms. Applegarth's class at Benito. It sounds like you guys are hot, hot, hot over there. Congratulations.
Yes, they're coming out quick out the gates. And we already have our 3rd challenge winner for 8th grade. Am I speaking with Ingrid from Broadbelt's class at Benito? Broadbelt's class at Benito. Hi, how you doing, Ingrid? You are a challenge winner for the night. You ready to show me how to do this problem?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go ahead and do it. So, the question says, the following side lengths and meters were given to you to build a front porch with a triangular design, and we want to see which option actually gives us a triangle. Before we go in about solving it, how do I figure out which of these options would give me a triangle?
So what you want to do is you want to add the numbers together. So
like which the numbers?
Lowest ones. I did the two lowest ones.
The two lowest ones.
The two lowest ones, right. So what you're saying is we have to take the sum of the two shorter legs. We know with triangles, those two are shorter are called legs.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to see if it is greater than the longest, right?
Yep.
Perfect. So let's go ahead and do that. So which option did you choose?
Option.
What was that?
I'm sorry, which one did you say?
Option 2.
Option 2. Ooh. There you go. That is correct. Because if we add our two shorter sides, 6 plus 8, what's 6 plus 8?
14.
Right, and 14 is greater than 10. So yes, that would work to make a triangle. The other two wouldn't work because 4 plus 4 is 8. 8's not greater than 8. And then 6 plus 6 is 12, and 12 is not greater than 13. So option 2 is the only one that works. Congratulations, you did a great job, Ingrid. You are going to be getting your Gemmy Award sent right to your class. Thank you so much for helping me with that problem.
Thank you.
Can we get some jingle bells on for those challenge winners?
Yeah, they
jingle
came real
bells,
quick.
Jingle bells, jingle all the way. There you go. Woo! Guys, that was amazing work. Thank you for doing the math with us. And then, are those firecrackers out here? Oh. All right, so we have our second question of the night on our board. So we are now done with all the challenge questions. That was super exciting. But now we're going to go spend some money. So let's pretend that you and your sister went to spend some money on mom and dad. And you spent $54.37 on mom and $77.43 on dad. Now, let's say you are equally going to split this with a sibling, with your sister. How much does each person pay? All right, so this is a word problem. You know, not everybody loves word problems, but you can do this one, and especially now for the holidays. You're thinking, I want to go spend some money. First off, I don't know about you, Grayson, but spending $54 on mom and $77.43 on dad. Mom got a little bit less pricey than what dad got. So I don't know about you, but my kids are always like, okay, let's try to keep it even. All right, so here we go. So if you and a sibling are spending money, but you want to split it equally with the final cost, how are you going to find that out? All right, so this is a two-step problem. First thing you have to do is add, and I don't have a student to do this with me right now, so that's why I'm doing this. For the viewing pleasure. So we're going to add how much it costs for those two gifts, right? So I lined up my decimals because this is good money's awareness, right? We have the two digits in front of the decimal and the two digits behind the decimal. So I line those up and I do my mathematics, and then from there I'm going to take whatever that is and I'm going to divide by two because it's just myself and a sibling trying to figure out how much each of us is going to pay. All right, let's do this mental math with us, if you will. 7 plus 3 is?
10.
Very good. Put 0, carry the 1. 4 plus 3 plus 1 is?
8.
Very nice. Nothing carried. 7 plus 4?
11.
11, carry the 1. And then 7 plus 5 plus 1?
13.
13. So they spent $131.80 in total for mom and dad, but we're going to divide that by 2. Again, I could do this quickly on a calculator on my phone or whatnot, but I'm going to put it here as we crank out those numbers real quick. Does 2 go into 1?
No, it does not.
It does not. Does 2 go into 13?
6 times.
6 times with a remainder of?
1.
1. So bring down my 1. Does 2 go into 11?
5 times.
5 times. There it is. I'm going to put my decimal since it's right there. Now, 5 times 2 is 10. Remainder of 1. Bring down that 8. Does 2 go into 18?
9 times.
9 times. So 9 times 2, guys, is 18. Nothing for a remainder, but we have that last 0 to bring down. So then there you go, Grayson. They spent $65.90 each on gifts for mom and dad.
We got some good gifts.
All right. You guys, we have another caller on the line. Is this Rami? Hey, Rami.
Yeah, yeah.
Rami, all right. You ready to do the problem with me, Rami?
Yeah, I'm a little nervous.
Don't be, all right? We're just going to tackle this, act like it's just in class, all right?
It's just Grayson and Maddie.
Yeah, no.
Okay.
I'll go easy on you, don't worry. All right, let's get started. So we have a multiple choice problem here. The question just says select all the true statements. So we have A, B, C, D, and E. We're just going to go through them, and we're going to pick which ones are true.
So is it multiple choice or is it select all?
It's select all. Well, okay. It's a select all multiple choice type of problem. Multiple choices to choose from. So
there you go.
The first one, A, says that pi is less than 3/2, 3/2. Do you know what pi equals?
I know it starts with 3.
Right, it does start with a 3. Pi is actually equal to 3.1459. A whole bunch of numbers, but whenever we round it in math, we usually just round it to 3.14. So this statement is saying that 3.14 estimated is less than 3 divided by 2, and 3 divided by 2 is 1.5. Does that make sense? 3.14 is less than 1.5?
No,
it does not. So we know that A is not an answer. It's not true. So let's get that out of there. B, the square root of 21 is greater than the cubed root of 125.
I think Rami knows how to do these.
Rami definitely knows how to do these
Rami,
ones.
What's the square root of 121?
I think it's 11.
It is 11. Good. Good job. And now the cubed root. Do you know how to do cubed root?
Is it five times five?
125. So this statement is saying that 11 is greater than 5. Is that true?
Yes,
it is. So then B is one of our true statements. Let's keep going. C, the square root of 49 equals 7. What's the square root of 49 equal?
7.
So this is true. 7 equals 7.
Yeah.
So C is another one of our true statements. Let's keep going. D, negative 1.66 is greater than negative 1 3/5. So there's a few ways that we can go about this one, but what I like to do is I want you to divide 3 divided by 5 for me, Rami. Can you do that for me?
Yeah.
So what is 3 divided by 5?
0.6.
0.6. So I have my negative 1, and I'm just going to put that 0.6 for 3/5, all right? Negative 1.6 is equivalent to negative 1 3/5. So this statement says negative 1.66 is greater than negative 1.6. Is that true when we're dealing with negatives?
No.
No, it is not.
Good job, Rami.
So let's get that D out of there. And we got one more, Rami. It says 3 divided by 8, or 3/8, is greater than 0.38. What is 3/8 as a decimal? You did 3 divided by 8.
Is it 0.375,
right?
You got it.
So we round up to 0.38.
So if it asked us to round, we would round, but it's not asking us to round, so we're just going to terminate it the whole way, 0.375, and because we're going to keep this value as exact as we can. Exactly. So it says that that's greater than 0.38. Is that true?
No,
it is not. Great job, Rami. So we have our answers B and C. You did fantastic. See, nothing to be worried about. Thank you so much for helping me with that problem.
Good job, Rami. And I think we have some jingle bells for you. There you go. Jingle all the way. We're going to jingle all the way home, guys, with all these great math questions. Arjun, are you there for us?
No, it is not.
Are you there?
Yes.
Let's do some math, all right?
Okay.
We are reviewing our semester one types of questions, and I have an expression on the board. The directions say calculate the value of the expression. So remember, an expression does not have an equal sign. So this is the expression that we have, the cube root of 8 plus 0.25, or 25 hundredths. Next to it is the square root of, and inside of that square root, we have 7 squared plus 15. What are you thinking when you see a problem like this?
I would just add the square
roots. Exactly. So we're talking about PEMDAs, right?
Yeah.
So we're definitely order of operations. So you wanted to start inside of the square root first?
Yes.
All right. So what do you want to do in there first?
So in that square root equation.
Yep.
Seven.
Yes.
Squared is 49.
Very nice. So that means 7 times 7, which is 49. And then still inside of that square root, I have the 15. So 49.
So you added 15.
You got it. So what are you going to get when you add the 15?
You would get 64.
Very nice. So I see the square root of 64. Now in front of it is still that 0.25, or that 25 hundredths, and then I'm just bringing everything down that we haven't used up yet, okay?
Okay.
So now where do we want to go? So we simplified inside of the radical, and now we have this shorter expression. Now what?
So now you find the square root of 64.
All right, so what is the square root of 64?
8.
Very nice. How did you know that?
Because 8 times 8 is 64.
Exactly. So 8 times 8 is 64. Beautiful thing. Again, I'm just writing everything down that we haven't used up just yet. With the order of operations, we do everything inside of that grouping symbol, right? Which happens to be that radical sign for us now. All right. So now it looks like we're adding and we're doing a multiplication step right over here. Which one do you want to do first?
I want to do the cube.
You want to do the cube root? All right, so you're going to tackle this cube root. All right, so what is the cube root of 8?
2.
Very nice. How did you know that?
Because 2 times 2 times 2 is 8.
Exactly. 2 times 2 times 2, so 3 2s multiplied together is going to give you 8. Now, a lot of kids don't like to look at fractions, but for this one, I'm going to actually write that 1, or that 0.25 as 1/4, because that's an equivalent form. Because sometimes it's a little bit easier to see it that way for mental math, right?
Right.
So what's 1/4 of 8?
So it's 2.
Very nice. So I'm hearing we have 2 from the front plus 2 from that back term.
Right.
All right. So what is our final step?
So add 2.
You got
and
it. I love it. And I love the fact that you self-corrected. That's a great mathematician. We collaborate. We go through it. We make sure that it's exactly what we wanted. Guess what? That checks out. And you are our next awesome Jingle Beller Winter Wonderland person. Congratulations.
I love the enthusiasm from all the callers tonight. All right. So we have some T-shirt award winners tonight. So shout out to them.
Giancarlo's?
Yes.
From?
We have Giancarlo's from Franklin. We have Dolly from Williams, and we have Sammy from Lutz. Congratulations to you all. You will be getting a t-shirt sent directly to your classroom. Keep calling in, get your friends to call, and win yourself some free food and your teacher some free food. Your whole class is free food. Everybody
free food for everybody.
Keep calling in, get everybody you know to call, all right? That's
all
what
right.
keeps the lights on.
Exactly. And guys, next we have a shout out to one of our sponsors, Ed Gems. If you notice on your screen, it's going to be one of our Ed Gems features or Gemmy features, which tonight happens to be the Target Tracker. So this is a self-assessment tool, and it's one of those things where you can use it in your workbook because you can see the little thermometers, you know, and things of that nature. And for every skill within that unit, you have a little thermometer that you can self-assess. That means you can just check yourself, like, where are you in that learning? So it's a reflection on your skills, it's tracking your progress, it's setting up goals for yourself. Definitely very interactive. We have the print version in the workbooks as well as the digital interactive version. So it's really fun to be able to track that. So it's in the beginning of each unit and you see that there. I know a lot of our students like to kind of check their progress and be able to show parents, hey, all that you know, as well as your teachers. All right, so thank you for our Target Tracker gem from Ed Gems.
Thank you so much, Ed Gems. I use Ed Gems every day in my class. I love them. They're very helpful.
You know what we have in the line?
Another caller?
Preston, last week's winner.
Oh, Preston. Can you hear me, Preston?
Hey, Preston. I think Preston's ready to do the next
Preston,
question.
Preston, you ready to do the next question with me?
Where did Preston go?
Oh, we might have lost him.
Hello?
Hey!
Hey, you there, Preston? You ready?
Oh, I'm ready.
Okay, let's get started then. I already have my problem set up for us, so if we can go to my board, let's get started. So my question says, which does not show the below ratios relationship? Do you know anything about ratios, Preston?
A little.
Okay, well, I'll let you know that, as a little hint, there's three different ways that we can write a ratio. And so, obviously, there's four options here. One of these ways is not correct. So let's just go about and do it together, okay? We have our red first, right? We have red first, and
yeah.
Then we have blue. So whatever, however we read this ratio, it's going to be from red first and then going to blue. How many reds do you see, red squares?
Three.
How many blues do you see?
Four.
And there's three different ways that we can write this to show the relationship of this ratio. So do you think A is one of the ways we can write it?
Yes,
it is, definitely. So we're going to leave that one alone. That shows out our relationship for this ratio. We can also write it as a fraction, right? 3 over 4, that's the same?
I believe so.
Right, and then there's one other way that we can write this out. I'm going to let you decide. Do you think it's C or D that we can write as a ratio? 3 to 4 or 3 comma 4?
C.
Right. 3, 2, 4. These are the three ways we can write a ratio. So then obviously, process of elimination. The correct answer for the one that does not show the below ratios relationship would be?
D.
Correct. Thank you so much, Preston. I hope you learned a little bit more about ratios tonight. Thank you so much for helping me with that problem. You did fantastic.
You guys caught me writing my next question, and we also have another caller on the line. Hey, Kareem. How's it going?
Hello?
Hi. We're getting ready to do some math, and we have a question that's talking about the best deal. Like, have you been to the stores lately, and you see how everybody's trying to kind of, like, Christmas shop a little bit?
Oh, yeah, Black Friday?
Yeah, exactly. And then today starts Hanukkah. So maybe, you know, people are shopping for Hanukkah gifts, you know, and things mm-hmm. of that nature. So we're going to have a party. We're going to throw a party. What do you think about that? And is that good? You lower your volume a little bit on the TV, okay? Basically, we're going to look at four stores online, and we want to see which one of these stores are we really going to buy from, because we're going to get some plates. Now, 8 plates at Party Town are going to go for $2.40. 12 plates at Fiesta Land are going to go for $3.84. 10 plates at Fun World are going for $3.49 versus 25 plates at Celebrate City are going for $6.25. So our job as mathematicians, we're going to be basically consulting here, you know, with our friends and family. Hey, which one's the better deal? So they're coming to you and they're asking you, where should we go shop at? So how are we going to tackle this?
All right. So what you want to do is look at the first. It says eight places at first. $2.40.
So $2.40, and we're going to do what with that?
Yes.
We're going to divide it by?
Eight.
All
right. Once you do that, you're going to get 30 cents.
30 cents, absolutely. I'm going to write it down like my little decimal here, okay?
All right,
so 30 cents at the first place. Doesn't seem so bad. Let's see if the other ones have a better deal or not, all right? What am I going to do for this Fiesta Land?
For the Fiesta Land, you're going to want a room of it.
All right.
So, what is 384?
384. We're going to divide that by what?
I believe by 4.
We have the 12 plates?
Yeah, because 84 times by 22. You have your set.
Right. So 384 is the cost for 12 plates. So we're going to take that and divide it like you did for the first one. And what is that going to give you per plate?
We already know. We don't know what's actual about 3. And
32 cents?
Yes.
All right. You did that beautifully. So far, if we only had to pick from these two, it sounds like Party Town would be better, right?
Yeah.
All right, but we got two more choices to go. So let's see what we have here. I think we're going to follow the same pattern of just dividing, right? So if you think about it, we're just getting the unit price. So per plate, how much are we spending? So what are we going to do for this fun world?
All right, so let's put 3 and 40 over 10.
Exactly. They're 349 over 10. And what is that going to give me for my decimal?
You can divide it by 7, I think, because 49 divided by 10 is 7.
Right. And then when I divide by 10, remember how I could just move my decimal 1 point to the left?
Yeah.
All right. So that's a little trick that I remember from doing my mental math. All right. And then we got one last one. So far it looks like still this Party Town is winning, right? As far as the best deal. All right. Let's check out this last one. We don't want to just say, oh, it's the first one, because you never know. This one, you get 25 plates, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Right. Let's
so
do it.
Let's just do the same thing and put $6.25 over 20.
Over 25? All right. And what do you get for that, honey?
So we can divide $6.05 by
the 25?
So it's going
to be. I'm using my calculator and I got it right away. Yeah. I don't know about you, but there's a lot of decimals and a lot of numbers here. So I got 25 cents. Is that what you got?
Yeah. 25
is
what?
So
25 times.
Mm-hmm. So which one is the better deal for us, Ms. Zeta?
So.
Or no, this is Kareem. It's Kareem. Which store are you going to tell your family to go to buy these plates at?
I think D.
Exactly, D. Jingle bells, jingle bells.
Yeah.
All right. Celebrate City. Wait. We're going to celebrate. You got that question right. Congratulations.
Great job. And I think we already have another caller. Am I speaking with Zeta from Hunt's class at Williams?
Yeah.
Hi, Zeta. You ready to do the math with me?
Yes, I am.
Okay, let's go ahead and tackle this problem. So, my problem says to basically just evaluate this expression that we have right here. You know anything about how to simplify an expression like this?
I can't actually see the problem right now.
Okay, so I'll give you a second until it loads on your screen, and I'll read it out for the people at home. So, our problem says we have 1/3 being multiplied to the value of 3 plus 3x plus 0.25 being multiplied to the value of 2x plus 8 minus 4x. So have you ever had to do with a problem where you have a value on the outside being multiplied to a value on the inside of a parentheses?
Yes.
Okay, so what should I do to be able to simplify that? Because I can't just add a 3 with a 3x, right? I can't add a constant with a coefficient, right?
Right.
So what can I do here?
You would first do 1/3 times 3.
Right.
And then to get 1.
Perfect.
And then you would do 1/3 times 3x, which is x.
Awesome. So for the people at home that don't know, in order for me to multiply these together, I can't add these first. I know, even though normally in PEMDAS, yes, parentheses would come first, I have to use the distributive property. So like Zeta said, I'm multiplying this outside value by both of these terms individually. So 1/3 times 3 is 1. 1/3 times 3x is just x. Let's keep going, Zeta. So we're going to do the same thing on the other side, right?
Right.
But on this other side, I have 3 values now instead of 2. Does that make a difference?
Kind of, right. Combine 2x and negative
4x. Great. So we have like terms right here that we can combine, 2x and a negative 4x. What will that give me?
Negative 2x.
Perfect. So I'm going to have 8 minus 2x now in that parentheses. What should I do from there?
Then I would do 0.25 times negative 2x.
Great, and we also have to multiply that by that 8, right? We can't forget about that.
Right.
So I'm going to move everything else down for now. 1 plus x plus, and now let's multiply these. What is 0.25 times 8? So a fourth, because that's what 0.25 equals, a fourth of 8.
Right. I believe that's 2.
That is.
Okay.
We have 2 right there, and then 0.25 times negative 2x.
That's 0.5x.
Right, so I'm going to put, don't forget that negative minus, so 0.5x. What should I do next?
Now you combine all like terms.
Perfect. What are my like terms?
1 and 2.
1 and 2, those are the only constants I see. And what are my other like terms?
X and negative 0.5.
Right, so let's write this out. Let's do our X's first, because I always like to put the X's in the front. What is X minus, so one, remember that's 1X, 1X minus 0.5X?
0.5X.
0.5x. Good. And now let's combine the other constants. 1 plus 2?
3.
3. So can I simplify this any further?
No.
No, but I like writing it as a fraction. So let's write this as a different way. What is 0.5 as a fraction?
1 half.
Perfect. So 1 half times x plus 3 is our final answer because these are equivalent, correct?
Yeah.
Great job. You did fantastic. Jingle bells for you.
Jingle bells. All right. And you guys, we keep going with the fun. So jingle all the way. Let's do this math. Preston, you're on the line with us.
Hello?
Hey Preston, you ready?
I
got a little bit of a challenge for you. I got not one, but 3 different expressions that we're going to go ahead and simplify. So if I have 2 parentheses x minus 8, and it's literally all it gives me for directions is simplify. What are we going to do with this expression?
I can't see the board here.
All right, no problem, honey. So I'm going to talk you through it. I have the 2 parentheses x minus 8. There might be a little bit of a delay.
Oh, I can see now.
Oh, yay. All right, so what am I going to do here to simplify? So make it with the least number of terms. Let's get rid of those parentheses. So remember, we're going to use the distribution property. And when we distribute, I'm not sure if Preston's still on the line with us. We're going to go ahead and multiply everything inside of the parentheses, guys, by that 2. Preston, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Oh, okay. So what happens when I double, basically, or multiply by 2 this x? What do I get?
You get 2x.
2x, beautiful thing. All right, so that got rid of the parentheses, but now I also have to multiply the 2 by this back term, right? That minus 8 or that negative 8?
Yeah.
And what do you do when you multiply those two together? What do you get?
You get negative 16.
You got it. All right, so right now after I multiplied inside of the parentheses by the 2, 2 times x, 2 times negative 8. Now, am I done here?
No.
Okay, what do you want to do next?
Oh, wait, hold on. Never.
You are correct. You are done because those are not like terms, right?
Yeah. Good.
Exactly. So we know that they're not like terms because this one has an x and this one does not. All right. So that was now looking at, that was A. Looking at B, now I have a negative 8. Inside of the parentheses, I have 2y plus 2. Let's use that same process, that same pattern, to get the answer for the part B expression. All right, Mr. Preston, you're on. What is negative 8 times 2y?
Negative 16.
Negative 16y. All right. And what is negative 8 times a positive 2?
Negative 16.
Beautiful. I love the fact that you remember your integer operations here. A negative times a positive is going to be a negative. So 8 times 2 is 16, and a negative times a positive is the negative 16. So beautiful thing. Am I done here?
Yes, you're done.
How do you know I'm done?
Because we can ask this equation to 15y, it has a variable with it.
Exactly. Beautiful thing, Preston. You're saying that this one has a y and this one does not. So they're not the same thing. It's like saying yo-yos and, I don't know, penguins, right? I can't put yo-yos and penguins together to make one number. So it's just the yo-yos and the penguins, right? All right. Last expression here that we have. We have 1/4, and 1/4 could be a little, I don't know, scary for some students because it seems like a fraction, but I know you got this. Same idea, we're going to multiply the 1/4 times each of the terms inside of that parentheses. What is 1/4 times 16x?
4x.
You are on fire. All right, what is 1/4 times negative 2?
1/2.
All right, so 1/2, but I'm going to make it a negative 1/2. Are you okay with that?
Yeah.
Because this is a positive and this is a negative 2, keeps that negative there, okay? All right, so 3 checks for you. I believe we have some jingle bells coming your way. Jingle all the way. You guys, this is so exciting. We're doing some math winter wonderland style, and we're down to the last few minutes of our show, so keep up with our doing our math here, our review time.
Yes, keep calling, and we already have another caller on the line. Am I speaking with Rami from Apple God's class at Benito?
Yes.
Okay, Rami, I love hearing from you. Let's go ahead and start this problem. So my problem is a two-part problem, all right? We have to solve first, and then we have to graph our solution on a number line over here. So do you know how to solve an inequality?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Okay, so solving this problem, what's the first thing that I need to worry about getting rid of?
Like the x over 3.
So I want to get x by itself, right?
Yeah.
So let's get rid of the constant of this inequality first. Which one is the constant on this side? The one without the variable.
3.
So that's the one without the variable. So not the 3, but the... The 7, all right?
Oh, so sorry.
Technically, no, it's fine. Technically, this 3, even though it's underneath the variable, it's still with that variable. It's technically, it's 1/3 times x. So we're not going to worry about that yet. We first need to get rid of the constant, the one without a variable, without that x. So we're going to do the inverse operation of minus 7. What is the opposite of subtracting a 7?
Dividing or adding.
Adding, right. The opposite of subtracting is adding. So we're going to add 7. To both sides, so we can get rid of it on this side. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Now, I want you to do this math for me. What is negative 6 plus a positive 7?
1.
1, right. Positive 1. So now we have 1 is greater than or equal to x divided by 3. And we're going to do similar operations to get rid of this 3, except instead of adding, because this is x divided by 3, what's the inverse operation of dividing?
Multiplying.
Right, so I'm going to multiply both of these sides by 3 so that I can get rid of that 3 over here, leaving me just an x. Now, what's the final value going to equal? What is x less than or equal to? What's 3 times 1?
3 times 1
is
3.
3. Beautiful. So we have 3 is greater than or equal to x. I always like to put the x on the left side just so we can follow that arrow on our number graph. So I'm going to rewrite it as x is less than or equal to 3. That's equivalent, right? Same thing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now we have our answer. X can be any value less than or equal to 3. So on my number line over here to the right, I'm going to go ahead and put my values. I'm going to put 3 right in the middle. On the right, I'm going to put values greater than 3. On the left, I'm going to put values less than 3. So I got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Mm-hmm. Now, where should I put my circle on this number line?
Your circle, it should be at the...
What's x less than?
3.
So I'm going to put that circle right at 3, right? Now keep
yeah.
in mind, this bar underneath the inequality lets us know that x is also equal to 3. It's including 3.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to fill in this circle, right, to represent that.
Yes.
All right, yes. And the last part of this problem, x is less than or equal to 3, so should I be going to the left to represent less than or to the right?
To the left.
To the left, to the left, to the left.
We are going to the left, and this number line now it graphs the representation that x is less than or equal to 3.
Good
Great
job,
Rami. You get jingle bells.
Woohoo!
Thank you.
So guys, we're getting ready to shout out our last sponsor with Just Mathnasium. Before we do that though, I wanted to give a shout out to Beefs and Lutes, everybody working out there tonight. Thank you, Jared. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Cindy. Thank you, Heidi. Thank you, Alyssa, Nikki, Alex, Ariel, Michelle, and Brittany. If I miss you, I'm so sorry, but shout out to Lutes, Beef or Brady's. With that being said, who is our sponsor for our show tonight?
Oh yes,
also?
Our great sponsor tonight is Mathnasium. Make math a priority this school year and discover why over a million parents have trusted Mathnasium to transform their children's math skills and build their confidence in math. They offer live face-to-face instruction offered both in-center and online, so you can get it multiple ways, and you can call them for a free assessment right now at any of their nearby locations. They have locations in Brandon, Carrollwood, New Tampa, Riverview, South Tampa, and West Chase. So please make sure to call them, take a picture of it right now, get that free assessment so that you can proudly support Mathnasium, just like they proudly support us here at Math Homework Hotline. Thank you so much, Mathnasium.
Getting that plus than A plus.
Yes.
All right, you guys, we are down, like we said, just to the last few minutes, last few questions of the evening. We have one of those wonderful select all types of questions for us. If you notice that phone number, our teachers are still taking calls from you. Call it hot on fire because you won't be able to talk to us until the next school year. No, next year, calendar year, 2024. We'll be back in January, we promise. All right, so that phone number, 813-840-7260. Teachers are ready to take your calls. With that being said, I don't necessarily have a caller right this second to be able to do our question, so we get to do it together. This select all. So we're going to select all the equations that represent a linear function. So Grayson, you get the honor of being my student leader here. Linear function. Exactly, guys. When I think linear, and I was working with students yesterday on this, the first four letters say line, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if I were to graph this equation, each one of these, which ones would give me a graph of a line? So that's really what this is asking. So a linear function, which ones of these is a line? So the first thing that I look for is always, this is my secret, so don't give away my secret, but always looking for x to the power of 1, all right?
Okay.
I'm also looking for y to the power of 1. So remember when you see those guys in equation forms, no longer are you going to see a 1 for the X or a Y. You're normally just going to see the letter X and the letter Y. Those are like invisible math powers, if you will. So here we go. If I look at A, Grayson, wait a minute. Is Y to the power of 1?
No, it is not.
Well, Y is.
Oh, well, Y is, sorry.
Here
the
it
X is.
I was looking at the X. Because we normally look at the X, right?
Yes.
I am. I was trying to trick him. So does X look like it's to the power of 1?
So X, it does look like it's to the power of 1, but it's in the exponent position.
Exactly. So X can now be an exponent. Wah, wah, wah.
Yeah, and if we're remembering about linear functions, it has to be in the form Y equals MX plus B.
So that's another great.
That is definitely not in that format.
Exactly. And even if it's in point slope, guys, those are you learning a little bit more advanced math. So X is the exponent. That is not going to work.
Yeah, that actually would give us an exponential function.
Exactly. What about this one? What is the power of the Y?
So the Y is to the power of 1.
Beautiful. What is the power of the X?
To the power of 1.
To the power of 1. That sounds like a linear equation to me. Ding, ding, ding. Jingle bells on that one. All right, guys. Here, be careful because Y, there you go. There are your jingle bells. Y is to the power of 1. But if I was going to make this expression really look like a slightly different expression with a power on it, the X would really be to the power of negative 1. So with negative exponents, it's not linear. X should not be a denominator. So again, that's not going to work. Mm-hmm.
That would give you a hyperbola.
Exactly. So a hyperbola. Here we go. The X is not necessarily going to look like Y equals MX plus B, but we could transform it that way. If I would have divided everything by 2, you know, made that an equivalent in form, definitely those are to the power of 1s. And then lastly, same thing here, going real quick, because we want to get to t-shirts as well. And we are down to the wire. So B, D, and E, looking at those tricks that we used, not only is it slope-intercept form, but you're looking for the powers of X and Y.
Yes, they are. And we have some t-shirt winners for tonight, some more to give out. You guys will be getting a t-shirt sent right directly to you, to your classrooms. Shout out to Tasia from Williams, Lola from York, and Aria from Franklin. Thank you so much for calling in.
Woo-hoo!
Keep calling in. Get your friends to call in. Get yourself another t-shirt. Thank you so much for supporting Math Homework Hotline.
They can be twinning with us.
Yes, they can.
All right. What is the next question, Grayson?
So I have a question already set up for us right here on my board. If we can go to it real quick.
We're down to the last minute,
yes,
I believe.
Yes, we are, but I'm going to knock it out.
Knock it out.
So my problem says CM equals 10 plus 3.85 times M. So this is basically saying that C, or whatever M equals, is the equation that we're using is 10 plus 3.85 times M. So how much per mile? Because we're talking about miles in this problem.
Mm-hmm.
So this is basically telling us that for every mile that it goes, it's going to cost $3.85. So part B is asking us, what is the value if we were to go 3 miles, if M was equal to 3? So we're going to write this as C equals 10 plus 3.85 times 3.
And I think our viewing audience can do that on their
yes,
own.
Can.
I know we can.
10 plus 11.55, and that gives us a value of $21.55 as our total.
Woo-hoo!
So we just banged that problem right out there.
You guys, like we said earlier in the show, we will be back in January for another live broadcast. January the 18th. Happy New Year, right? So
yeah.
Early wishes for a great holiday season, whether you're celebrating Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, Merry Christmas, but Happy New Year, guys. Thank
happy
you for this season
and your families.
Of math. January the 18th, mark that on your calendar. We'll see you back then with a Happy New Year theme.
Thank you so much for joining tonight. Have a great night, everybody.